Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the City of Muskegon City Commission meeting for November 22nd, 2016. Before we begin the proceedings, I'd ask everyone to stand. And is Bishop Nathaniel Wells Jr. In the audience? Well, we will have a prayer, and followed by the prayer, we will say the Pledge of Allegiance. So, if you will join me. Let us ask for the grace of gratitude. Gratitude for this evening hour and the opportunity to come together for the sake of our fellow citizens and working towards all good things for the city of Muskegon and beyond. And let us also pray for the grace of gratitude for all good things that we share in common and the ability to work peacefully in assuaging our differences. May we ask for the grace of gratitude for the homes that we have, either the greatest or the smallest. And may we ask for the grace to share the good things that we have with the least among us, especially this time of year, where so much emphasis is given to holidays. May they also become holy days. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have the roll call, please?
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Here.
Commissioner German? Absent. Commissioner Rinsen-Masivinga?
Here.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Here.
Well, that sounds like enough.
Okay.
Cool. Before we get into the meat of the business this evening, Chief Lewis?
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners in the audience. We're back here again in the fall of 2016. We just graduated our 28th Police Citizens Academy. It is something that we have done as a community engagement or outreach to our citizens so they have an idea on how their police services and actually the criminal justice system works in Muskegon County. It started in 2002 and now in 16 we just concluded our 28th session. So tonight we're going to honor the graduates. We started out with 14 eager people back in August. It's always tough to get them there right at the end of summer. They finished up in October, and now the commission and the committee has a chance to see who these people are that participated in the Citizens Police Academy. One thing I want you to know is we're going to run another one in 2017 in the spring. It's an excellent opportunity for anyone basically above 17 years old to see what goes on in the criminal justice system. We start out with dispatch, patrol bureau, investigations, domestic violence, the neighborhood policing, records retention, special policing. They make a tour to the jail. The prosecutor comes in and does a session. They do a lot on evidence gathering. And the last night, our evidence technicians and detectives take them into the basement to a real live crime scene. And that's always great to watch what happens there. So tonight, we've invited those individuals to come. And Mayor, could you come on down and read the resolution, and we'll get this thing going.
Yeah, Patrick, for me. Well, I'd like to welcome all of our graduates and participants this evening. Actually, thank you so much for having taken the opportunity to engage at this level with our city staff and see the realities and to develop those relationships. And with that, now you have the ability to talk to your next door neighbor and the people on the other side of the alley and anybody else that you run into. And you have some great facts about what's done how it's done, the dedication, you know, the work, and how these folks serve our community. So again, thank you for your time, thank you for your efforts, because it makes us stronger when you're stronger. So with that being said, a resolution of recognition of the Fall 2016 Citizens Academy graduates. Whereas the City Commission desires to provide citizens with a better understanding of the functions of law enforcement, dispelling misconceptions, and increasing positive communication between citizen and police, and whereas it is the desire of the Muskegon City Commission to encourage cooperation between the public and law enforcement to positively impact our communities, now therefore be it resolved that the Muskegon City Commission hereby congratulates and recognize.
Do you want me to go ahead and the individual names, or did you want to?
I'll call them out.
Okay, but all of you. For your faithful attendance, completion, and graduation from the 10 weeks of the Fall 2016 Citizens Police Academy. And we'll be presenting not just this parchment paper, but our best wishes and extensions, you know, from our hearts for what you put into this, myself and my fellow commissioners.
Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and read the names one at a time. I'm going to give you all of those. And if they will come stand up front and shake the hands and receive their resolution from the mayor and director of public safety. And I think we've actually got four of our students here tonight, but I'm going to read all the names and just come up when you hear your name. Okay, Gretchen Botka, Tyshawn Bibbs, Katarina Christensen, Faye Redmond, Alyssa Shelton, Alexis Smith, and Sonia White. Okay, I'd like to congratulate them. If we could give them a hand, they actually committed 10 weeks to this program.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Okay, and if I can, I just want to do a little plug right now for the Citizens Academy, because we are right now accepting applications for the spring, which starts the fourth Wednesday in March. And you can actually go to shorelinecity.com or muskegonpolice.com, and you'll actually find a link to the Citizens Academy page. One thing I want to stress is that this is done totally free, and we bring in a multitude of agencies. It's not just the Muskegon Police Department. You've got the prosecutor's office, every woman's place to talk about domestic violence. You've got the sheriff's office. We've got family court. Takes you through the entire criminal justice system. The thing is, it's totally free. And all these people come in here, and they donate their time from these other agencies to come put this on, because I think it's really important to get good information out there, because one of the big things we try and do is dispel misconceptions that are out there. So this is the place to come and get good information, and it's totally open forum. You can ask questions all night long. It is a commitment of one night a week for 10 weeks. It's on Wednesday evenings from 6 to 9 p.m. So if you're interested, I would encourage you to attend, or if you know anybody that's interested in going into criminal justice, it goes anywhere from 17 years old on up. And we get people that are interested in criminal justice showing up, and we get the general public showing up. And, you know, retired people, they just want more information on the system. So please spread the word. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any members here from the Muskegon Area Free Fitness Club? There is. There is. Hey, will you join me up here? Hey, this evening we have a number of individuals from the Muskegon Area Free Fitness Club, and they come here this evening
representing and really showing what volunteerism in the city of Muskegon can do. Over on the east side of town, there's Joe Clifford Park, and I believe the pavilion there has been kind of deteriorating over the years, so you're all stepping up in order to help out with that effort. Is that correct?
Yes.
Very good, very good. So we always like to recognize the blood, the sweat, and the tears of our fellow citizens that help us keep this community going. So whereas volunteering of one's time and resources is an undisputed part of our heritage, as it's essential to our nation's well-being, and whereas we are a nation of people who thrive on helping others as well as ourselves to a better life, whereas to achieve the kind of society we hope to build for ourselves and for our children, we need to work together in a spirit of brotherhood and cooperation for the betterment of all our citizens. And whereas government alone cannot solve all of our society's problems, because you are the government along with us, and because of their magnitude and nature, and whereas thousands of our citizens work each day not for profit or recognition, but to build stronger communities and to serve human needs, and whereas volunteers transform limited resources into unlimited possibilities, as well as offering love and compassion, proven leadership and hope, bringing families and communities together, and turning dreams into realities. And whereas it's important for all of us to recognize our responsibilities and follow the example of volunteers by giving of ourselves for the betterment of all, now therefore the City of Muskegon honors and thanks the Muskegon Area Free Fit Club volunteers for their dedication to the citizens of our community who have given so freely of their valuable time, energy, and abilities to help save the pavilion at Joe Clifford's Park. I'd like to present this to you all on behalf of myself and the commission and the citizens of Muskegon. Thank you very much. And you can go have dinner, or you can sit and watch all this fun. May we have the consent agenda, please?
Approval of minutes. City Clerk, summary of request to approve the minutes of the October 25, 2016 regular City Commission meeting and the November 7, 2016 work session meeting. Staff recommendation, approval of the minutes. Approval of revised citizenship participation plan, specifically the period for citizen comments from Community and Neighborhood Services. Summary of request, to approve a revision of the citizen participation plan clarifying the length of time allowed for citizens to comment. The change would reduce the number of days required for a formal comment period from 30 days to either 15, 20, or 30 days. Staff recommendation to approve the request. Committee recommendation, item was approved by the Citizens District Council. Sale of a non-buildable vacant lot at 1296 Lakeshore Drive from Planning and Economic Development. Summary of request, to approve the sale of a vacant non-buildable lot at 1296 Lakeshore Drive to five different adjacent property owners located at 1487 High Street, 1492 High Street, 1294 Lakeshore Drive, 1298 Lakeshore Drive, 1284 Lakeshore Drive. The lot is roughly 0.92 acres and is considered unbuildable because of its location on a steep hill and the general intent of its zoning classifications. It is zoned OSC, Open Space Conservation. These districts are intended to provide for permanent open spaces in the community and the protection of sand dunes and other natural features, and are designed to provide undeveloped recreational areas and to safeguard the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens of Muskegon and adjacent areas by limiting development in locations where police and fire protection, protection against flooding by high water table or storm water, and dangers from excessive erosion are not possible without excessive cost to the city. The property owners wish to purchase the property to prevent any future developments and to be able to maintain the property. They have offered $8,000 plus the cost of the survey, which is $2,147, and all closing costs. Staff recommendation to approve the lot sale request. Request to add parcels to the city's existing groundwater ordinance. Second reading from Planning and Economic Development. Summary of requests. The commission previously approved the parcels to be added to the groundwater ordinance regarding the former mobile oil pipeline at Sisson Avenue and McCracken Street on August 23rd, 2016, ordinance 2355. However, the applicant listed the wrong parcel numbers on the application, but they did mail notices to the correct addresses. Staff is requesting to repeal the ordinance 2355 and replace it with a new ordinance with the correct parcels listed. The ordinance prohibits the use of groundwater wells and secondary water supplies under certain circumstances and in certain locations to prevent exposure to contaminated groundwater, as well as to prevent wells from influencing the movement of contaminated water. Notice was sent to the affected addresses prior to this meeting. Staff recommendation, approval of the ordinance amendment to add the additional 52 parcels. Item E, towing contract extension for Ramos Towing Services, Public Safety. Summary request. The Director of Public Safety requests that the City Commission review and consider approving a contract extension with our current service provider, Ramos Towing. Currently, Ramos provides towing impoundment storage service for the City of Muskegon. Ramos Towing has been under authorized contract services for towing for the last 3 years, from January 14 of 2014 to January 14 of 2017. Ramos Towing is willing to extend the towing services for 1 year until January 14, 2018, as allowed in the current contract. Staff recommendation, staff recommends approval of this extended towing contract agreement for 1 year. Item F, wireless internet at Muskegon Farmers Market, City Clerk. Summary of request. Currently, the farmers market cannot connect to the City of Muskegon's network. Because of this issue, they are unable to have a City of Muskegon email or use the programs currently available to other employees. They are using a much slower provider. Connecting the market to the city's infrastructure is a specialty service that few can provide. The IT department was able to receive a quote from MapleNet Wireless to install the wireless link. With this capability, we will be able to utilize our Cisco phone system and eliminate a $293.44 monthly bill, a payback of approximately 2.5 years while increasing our bandwidth tremendously. This will not provide better wireless internet to the customers at the market, but it is a feature we will be reviewing in the future. Staff recommendation to authorize MapleNet to install a wireless link to connect the Muskegon Farmers Market to City Hall and select option 2 in the amount of $8,914.29 based on the recommendation of the IT department. Item G, two entry-level positions in IT from Information Technology. Summary of request. Recently, our database administrator left for a new position. Currently, there are only two employees supporting over 200 city employees, including City Hall, police, water filtration, fire department, farmers market, etc., as well as external agencies, including the cities of North Muskegon, Roosevelt Park, and Montague. As such, the IT department finds itself in a position to restructure the department. The IT department would like to move from an administrator position to two entry-level technical positions. One of the positions will be full-time and the other part-time. Staff recommendation to create two entry-level technical positions in the IT department.
Commissioners, you've heard the consent agenda as presented. Are there any items you wish to have removed for further discussion? Mr. Turnquist.
If not, I move that we accept the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
This has been moved by Commissioner Turnquist, seconded by the Vice Mayor, to accept the consent agenda as presented. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Mayor Gowron.
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood.
Yes.
Commissioner Warren.
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsema-Sibinga.
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist.
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Public hearings, please.
Item A. A request to establish an obsolete property district at 1740 East Sherman Boulevard from Planning and Economic Development. Summary of request. Pursuant to Public Act 146 of the Michigan Public Acts of 2000, Pacifica Muskegon LLC has requested the establishment of an obsolete property district for their property at 1740 East Sherman Boulevard. The establishment of the obsolete property district would allow them to apply for an obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate. Staff recommendation Staff recommends approval of the obsolete property district.
Mr. Franzik, good evening.
Good evening. So this is for the former Target building on Sherman. We need to establish the district first and then decide if we want to grant the certificate. And they will be investing $1.5 million in the rehab, which qualifies them for a 12-year abatement. And we do have Patricia Gibbs, who is the attorney for the Pacifica Company here, if you have any questions for her.
Okay. Do we have any questions for staff while we have Mike up at the podium?
What kind of zoning, the Target at the, what, east end of Sherman?
Yes.
Was there for Target, and how long has that building been there?
I believe 1998 was when it was.
So did we as a city at that time do some special zoning or?
There were not any abatements to my knowledge on it, no.
Okay. Commissioner?
Yeah, there's a lot of talk about big boxes and how they, when they go vacant, they don't provide much tax support to the city. Is the taxable value similar to what it was when it was occupied, or what's the baseline?
I do have what they paid last year. The Target Corporation last year paid, summer taxes were roughly $9,400, and the winter taxes were roughly $42,000.
Yeah. So no. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay. Anything here, commissioners? Okay. And Ms. Gibbs, you join us this evening?
Thank you very much. Good evening, Your Honor.
Good evening, Counselor. How are you?
I am delighted to be here, although I confess I was a little bit shell-shocked by the weather adjustment. Our offices are in San Diego, so I had to...
Well, we love you anyway. Welcome, Ms. Keegan.
Well, thank you. So it's a pleasure to be here this evening because we are excited about this project. We acquired it from Target in August, I believe. At that point, of course, it had been vacant for nearly 8 years.
Right.
And that's a sad situation for an area which is otherwise fairly economically vibrant. It is vacant and has been for 8 years for the very reason that you established. Big box users are just not that easy to come by anymore. This is a 96,000+ square foot footprint for the building, and it just can't be sustained with the current players in the market. The retailers, of course, are shrinking down a little bit. So we acquired this with the idea of putting together a group of users. I think the application said at least two, and that's a tenant, but I think at this point we're pretty clear that this is a three-tenant development, which means we'll have to demise the building. In addition, we hope over time to also be able to come back to you with a request for an out parcel, but we're not quite there yet. We have to have some permissions from the folks who own adjacent lands, and of course, you know, we have to find a tenant. But first and foremost, we need to take the existing building and bring it back to a standard that everybody would want to have in their building. Target is a great company, you know, they do a nice job, but it has been vacant for 8 years, and during that time, there's been, you know, zero improvement. And the, of course, weather and just the passage of time has been hard on the building. But more to the point, the kinds of infrastructure that worked in 1998 just don't work now. It's not energy efficient. We need to do some massive overhauls of the electric system, of the HVAC. We'll have to have all new heating and ventilation. It will have to have the structural supports and the roof in order to support the HVAC. It has a 2-inch gas line for that big building. We'll have to have a 3-inch high-pressure gas line. We'll have to, and I'm sure you're all familiar with the Target and the Meijer concept, the restrooms are at the front of the building. That only works for the large big box users. It doesn't work for any other kind of user. Restrooms have to go to the back, and anybody who's done any work in their home probably knows that plumbing is a huge expense because, of course, it's underground. The ceiling grid is done. In addition to just having ceiling tiles, which are kaput, the grid, the entire grid has to be redone, and the floor is done. The tile was, of course, you know, used as you would expect over time, but then also every place that they had a rack, there's an imprint on the floor. So really, you have to take out the entire floor in order to make this work. For a multi-tenant building, and I swear I'm almost done.
We like information.
Okay, well, good. You need to have an anchor presentation, so that it looks like an entrance that you would want to approach for any of your larger target, any of your larger buildings. And of course, Target only had its prototypical landscape, which has, you know, one with a little color, thin color strips that run around the building. That obviously only works for Target. It doesn't work for any other user. So we need to freshen that up, and there are some places where it's actually damaged, so we just have to start from scratch at the front. This project works for us, and I think it would work for any developer, only with some assistance. The assistance that we're looking for is really the public-private partnership that I think most of us want to endorse, where you help us a little bit, we put in the capital, you hold back on the real estate taxes by giving us an obsolete property exemption for the period that we have requested. And then with a little bit of luck, the tenants that we have contacted, we can pull the trigger on. As you can imagine, it's been 8 years and vacant for that time because it isn't economically viable without some assistance. So that's the description of our project. I have a little floor plan, but I suspect most of you know what a Target looks like. I'm happy to share this if anybody wants a copy. It's not really all that exciting. It does show one tenant. I'd like to keep that between you, me, and the gatepost until we have it finalized, but I can share a floor plan if anybody wants it. Sure.
You may. And remember, you're all gateposts.
Okay. It's different sizes, you can see in there. Big sizes, I've got little sizes, medium sizes, whatever you want, so.
Thank you. You want these
back, Councilor? I actually would prefer to collect them.
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
There is a PetSmart depicted, but of course that's the adjacent site that's off our
property. You can have these ones right here.
Well, we don't have a done deal yet, so.
Yeah, that they'd self-destruct in your hands in 5 seconds.
I was waiting on that.
So with that, I'm happy to entertain any questions that anyone has about the project.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes,
Speaking of you not having a done deal yet, basically getting the tenants to sign is predicated on you getting these incentives, being able to offer them the square footage that you've already presumably quoted them on a per square foot cost?
It is, and this works by holding the taxes as they are. That only is possible, you know, with your assistance. And the discussions that we've had with all the tenants for this site have been predicated on this going through. Mm-hmm. And in fact, we had discussions early on to see about the feasibility of this program with staff before we acquired it. Of course, that came with no promises, but we were hopeful that would be able to be accepted by the council.
And you foresee owning this, you're not just gonna get the incentives, develop it, flip it. You foresee continuing owning it and managing it and renting it out to tenants?
Absolutely.
For the foreseeable future, at least?
Well, I'm hoping that we rent it, you know, and it's rented for a while.
Yeah.
But other than that, absolutely. And we are excited about the out parcel. We've had some good positive feedback from the owner of the Pizzoli's. I've had lots of conversations with the owners of the adjacent company, which is a development firm out of Florida. They had some concerns about what kind of users might be there to be competitive with their existing users, so we agreed that, you know, we wouldn't have anybody who competed directly with those users.
Mm-hmm.
So we do anticipate making this investment, holding on to it for quite a while. I'm not all this keen on releasing it over and over again. I want to release it and be done with it.
Has Pacifica invested or done any other projects in Muskegon or the West Michigan area? Or is this your
Pacifica Companies has been
intro.
Around for 35 years, has a good-sized footprint in the hospitality industry, in senior living, in multifamily, and a smattering of projects in office and retail. As of December of 2015, they hired a full-time retail director, vice president of that division, to start work in the retail area. Is a serious, more serious endeavor than the smattering of projects that came along that were opportunistic. That gentleman and I had worked together for some 15 years, so I came in July, and we have three sites that we have are within days of having closed on, two that we've closed on, this being the first one, another one being in Monroe, Michigan, and a third in Mason, Michigan next week. But we have approximately 25 properties, primarily in the Midwest, that we have under contract or under a letter of intent to acquire and start investing in. The gentleman that I mentioned, who's the leader of this division, and I both are from Rockford, Illinois, so we're very familiar with the upper Midwest. He, in fact, has spent a huge amount of time in Michigan, and we look forward to making a concerted effort to having Michigan as a significant portion of our retail division.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you for coming here to, tonight and briefing us. Also, I am supportive of the incentive. Honestly, when I first saw it, my initial thought was obsolete property rehabilitation certificate. I was like, that was a big box retailer, going to become a big box retailer. How does it, you know, how does it justify it? But given the level of investment, $1.5 million going into upgrade it, there's significant upgrades being made. So I can see the justification of saying, you know, the rationale for an obsolete property rehabilitation certificate. And not only that, the prospect of creating over 100 jobs.
Absolutely.
So we I think it's, like you said, public-private partnership, and I think it's a win-win situation for our city and our residents and you. And hopefully it's a smashing success, profitable, and you'll look to other investments in our city and our surrounding community and maybe even some new builds elsewhere. We've got a lot of opportunities.
Appreciate the endorsement. We actually did look at an unimproved property in Muskegon. We haven't, I'm not going to describe where for some obvious reasons.
Pass it around on a piece of paper.
But we anticipate very much so being invested in Michigan.
Excellent. Thank you.
Appreciate that. Any other questions for Ms. Gibbs? Not. Are there any? You can go ahead and take us.
Thank you, gentlemen. Ma'am.
Thank you.
Are there any members of the public that would like to speak on this request to establish the obsolete property district? If not, Commissioner Rinsma-Sabinga.
I move we close the public hearing and move for the approval of the obsolete property district.
Support. It's been moved by Commissioner Rinsma-Sabinga, supported by Commissioner Johnson, to close the public hearing and approve the obsolete property district for 1740 East Sherman Boulevard. Any further discussion? That roll call, please.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsma-Sabinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Bowron?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Mike, we have the attendant issue of item B, right? So why don't we lead off on that, Madam Clerk?
A request to issue an obsolete property certificate for Pacifica Muskegon LLC at 1740 East Sherman Boulevard from Planning and Economic Development. Pursuant to Public Act 146 of the Michigan Public Acts of 2000, Pacifica Muskegon LLC has requested the issuance of an obsolete property certificate for their property located at 1740 East Sherman Boulevard. The estimated cost for rehabilitation of this property will be $1.5 million. The application is eligible for a 12-year abatement because of the amount of investment. Staff recommendation, staff recommends approval of the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate.
So we've created the district. This now presents it with the certificate. Any additional questions for staff? They've probably been asked and answered. Are there any members of the public that would wish to input on the actual issuance of the certificate for 1740 East Sherman Boulevard? If not, Commissioner Warren.
I move we close the public hearing and approve the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate for 1740 East Sherman Boulevard.
Support.
It has been moved by Commissioner Warren, seconded by Commissioner Rinsma Savinga, to close the public hearing and approve the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate for 1740 East Sherman Boulevard. Any further questions or discussion? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsma Savinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. And Councillor, please extend our warmest welcome to the group, and we hope to develop a long-standing and profitable relationship in the coming years.
Thank you, Mr. Wade.
Thank you.
Safe travels. And
safe travels back out to the West.
Thank you very much.
You betcha. New business.
Item A, first quarter 2016-17 budget reforecast. Finance Director. Summary of request. At this time, staff is transmitting the first quarter 2016-17 budget reforecast, which outlines proposed changes to the budget that have come about as a result of changes in revenue projections, policy programs, labor contracts, updated economic conditions, and other factors. Staff recommendation, approval.
I move we approve the first quarter 16-17 budget reforecast.
Support. It has been moved by Commissioner Rinsma Savinga, supported by the Vice Mayor, to approve the first quarter 2016-2017 budget reforecast. Good evening, sir.
How are you? Good evening. For the first quarter, we just had a few, I guess, relatively minor tweaks and all things considered for the budget reforecast for the first quarter. In general, overall, the general fund is being reforecast for revenues to go down net $115,000 from the original budget amount. And on the expenditure side, the projection is to reforecast the general fund expenditures to increase by $40,000 in total. There was some refinement to the capital budget as well, primarily some shifting and some specifically identifying certain elements of certain projects within capital. But that resulted in a net decrease of $14,000 from the original capital budget that was approved. Any specific questions of the commission at this time?
Questions, gentlemen? Questions, lady and gentlemen? Mr. Johnson.
I was just curious on the budget. I didn't see a breakout for the farmers market in Kitchen 242. It was absent. Has that
actually
been removed? For
that's in process right now. For the approved 2016-17 budget, the farmers market, as it has historically had been, was part of it. Was just a cost center of the general fund. We're in the process during this current fiscal year of moving the farmers market to its own separate fund itself, to track that separately in a separate fund to account for the activity of the farmers market. So the anticipation is by between the second and third quarters to have that totally broken out into its own separate fund and start reporting on it as a separate fund
together. Okay, because the components were separate.
Yes.
Now we're going to combine them into a single fund.
Correct. Yes.
Okay, gotcha. But no significant changes.
No
from
changes
what we
at
forecast
this point
with regard to those two components.
No changes at this point. It's the same status as of the original approved 16-17 budget within the general fund.
Okay. And my only other comment is that hopefully that city income tax is just a hiccup that we saw lower than expected. That has been a kind of a workhorse in recent years of coming in higher than what we expected and estimated. So hopefully that's just a brief hiccup.
Hopefully,
and we'll continue to see growth.
What we've seen over the last month or so is a couple of significant refunds that were required to go back to a couple of corporate taxpayers.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you.
All right.
Commissioner Turnquist.
So this is like a negative factor of $155,000 first quarter?
The net.
Between the additional expenditures and less income.
Correct.
And that's to the general fund.
That's to the general fund, yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else, commissioners? Thank you, Derek.
Sure. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Rinsma Savinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item B, please.
Commercial chemical spreader sprayer for DPW Summer of request. Authorize staff to purchase one Z-Max commercial spreader sprayer from Site One Landscape Supply, the lowest qualified bidder, with a bid price of $11,455. The other bid was submitted by LT Rich Products for $11,455.77. This request is contingent upon first quarter budget reforecast approval. Staff recommendation to authorize staff to purchase one Z-Max commercial chemical spreader sprayer.
I move to we approve the purchase of the commercial chemical spreader sprayer.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Rinsman-Savinga, supported by the Vice Mayor, to authorize staff to purchase one Z-Max commercial chemical spreader sprayer. Questions? Commissioner Turnquist?
Have we ever had a bid so close, 77 cents? You must have supplied somebody some information. You could have said yes or no from that.
No.
Thank you.
Were those the only two bidders? So I didn't see a bidding worksheet in the packet. So those were the only two bidders?
That's why I put it in the summary.
Okay, gotcha. And neither of them are local? Okay, gotcha. Thank you.
May I borrow the spreader on it? No, I can't. I can't.
You don't know how to drive it.
Any other questions?
It's not a question per se. It's kind of an aside to this, and I just thought of this now, is that we've heard complaints from some residents about chemicals and our pesticide spray and wanting some kind of notification system. And I just wanted to convey that and share that with staff. I'm sure you may have heard it as well, Frank. Maybe you want to give some thought how we might be able to either set up a system that people can ask to be notified with a text message, if it could be automated. Obviously, we don't want staff making phone calls or sending out text messages and taking up our scarce resources. But if there might be a way to set up an auto notification system, or even just posting it on a page on our website, so those that are exceptionally sensitive to that can go and check, like, okay, farmer's market is getting sprayed this week. I don't want to go down there this week. Just to maybe be a little bit more proactive in terms of addressing our resident sensitivities to the chemical sprayer. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Rinsman-Savinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item C, please.
Transfer of the Commercial Rehabilitation Exemption Certificate at 316 Morris Avenue from Planning and Economic Development. Summary of request. The Hinman Company was approved for a Commercial Rehabilitation Exemption Certificate in 2013, and the certificate was applied to the entire building. However, the project only included the rehabilitation of floors 1 through 5 and did not include floors 6 and 7. The certificate was approved for 10 years, and the company did invest $450,000 in upgrades as described in the application. The company would like to transfer the Commercial Rehabilitation Exemption Certificate number C-2013-11 from the entire building, floors 1 through 7, to floors 1 through 5. This will allow them to apply for a Neighborhood Enterprise Zone Certificate for floors 6 and 7 for their apartment project. Currently, they would not be able to apply for a Neighborhood Enterprise Zone Certificate because there is already an abatement on floor 6 and 7, and the Michigan Economic Development Corporation does not allow multiple tax abatements at the same location. Staff recommendation, approval of the Commercial Rehabilitation Exemption Certificate transfer.
Vice Mayor.
I move to approve the Commercial Rehabilitation Exemption Certificate transfer at 316 Morris Avenue.
Support. It has been moved by the Vice Mayor, supported by Commissioner Johnson, to approve the Commercial Rehabilitation Exemption Certificate transfer at 316 Morris Avenue. Take her away, Mike.
All right, so when we granted this a couple years ago, the city and the company were both under the impression that it was just for floors 1 through 5. The State Tax Commission notified us and told us that it was on the entire building. So This all came about because of the NEZ that we want to approve for this, for the floors 6 and 7, but you can't stack abatements on top of each other. So they kind of walked me through the process of what we need to do. We need to transfer the certificate from the whole building to floors 1 through 5. Then we need to revoke the certificate for floors 6 and 7. And then we need to approve the NEZ, and it has to happen in that order.
Questions, commissioners? Vice Mayor.
Yes, can you repeat that again, please?
Sure. So, the commercial rehab exemption certificate was granted in 2013. It only included work on floors 1 through 5 and did not include floors 6 and 7. So, they would like to get the neighborhood enterprise zone certificate on floors 6 and 7, but you cannot do that because there's already an abatement on floors 6 and 7, which is the commercial rehab certificate. So since the work for the commercial rehab exemption certificate only took place on floors 1 through 5, we can transfer the certificate from the whole building, 1 through 7 floors, to floors 1 through 5. And then after we transfer that, we need to revoke that exemption certificate on floors 6 and 7, and that will free it up to be able to grant the neighborhood enterprise zone.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And also, I'd just like to mention, we do have Mr. James Pollock from the Hinman Company here representing the company for any questions.
Very good. Any questions?
Roll call, please.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Garvin?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Sabinga?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. And now the next part to this, item A.
Revocation of a portion of the commercial rehabilitation exemption certificate at 316 Morris Avenue from Planning and Economic Development. Summary of request. In order to apply for the Neighborhood Enterprise Zone certificate for floors 6 and 7, the commercial rehabilitation exemption certificate must be revoked on these floors. Staff recommendation, approval of the revocation of a portion of the commercial rehabilitation exemption certificate.
Vice Mayor.
I move to approve the revocation of a portion of the commercial rehabilitation exemption certificate at 316 Morris Avenue.
Support. It's been moved by the Vice Mayor, supported by Commissioner Rinsen-Sabinga, to approve the revocation of a portion of the commercial rehabilitation exemption certificate at 316 Morris Avenue. Any questions? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Garvin?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Sabinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Motion passes.
And now the third part of this quilt, item E.
Approval of a Neighborhood Enterprise Zone Certificate at 316 Morris Avenue from Planning and Economic Development. Summary of request. An application for a Neighborhood Enterprise Zone Certificate has been received from Hinman Lake LLC for the conversion of offices to apartments on the 6th and 7th floors of their building at 316 Morris Avenue. The estimated project cost is $1,777,200 and will include 20 market-rate apartments. The property was approved as a Neighborhood Enterprise Zone District on September 13, 2016. The applicant has met local and state requirements for the issuance of the NEZ certificate. Staff recommendation, approval of the NEZ certificate.
Commissioner Rinsen-Sabinga?
I move approval of the NEZ certificate at 316 Morris Avenue.
Support. Been moved by Commissioner Rinsen-Sabinga, seconded by Commissioner Johnson, to approve the Neighborhood Enterprise Zone Certificate for 316 Morris. Questions, comments? Commissioner?
The NEZ district that we granted on September 13, is that just for the 6th and 7th floors?
It's for the entire building.
Okay.
But this but is the just certificate would be just for the 6th and 7th
okay.
floors.
And that's all right?
Yes, potentially in the future,
if they wanted to
the
do
first
more
floor wanted to be residential, then they would have the opportunity to apply for a certificate.
And we'd have to go through the same thing of revoking the commercial rehab on that floor?
Well, that's correct, yes, because there's still a commercial rehab.
Yeah. But you can have overlapping districts, just
you can have overlapping districts, just not certificates.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. Any Any other questions? And our representative from Hinman Group is... I just wanted to express that we have some lovely, lovely empty lots that would accommodate 40-story buildings. So.
And they're larger than...
But supposedly we certainly appreciate the attention and the investment in Muskegon and are looking forward to this project. It's very exciting. So please extend my best to the group.
I will. Thank you. We're very excited about it as well. So looking forward to starting soon on the project, actually. So it should be commencing soon. So we're excited about it.
Very good. Thank you. Roll call, please.
Mayor Garen?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner Runzema Sibica?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Last item.
Adopt a resolution of intent regarding recreational authority from the city manager. Summary of request. To express the intent of the city of Muskegon to establish a recreational authority within the county of Muskegon and to appoint a representative of the city of Muskegon to join with the representatives from other like-minded municipalities to form a steering committee to prepare articles of incorporation for such a regional recreational authority, which would include the city of Muskegon within its territory. Staff recommendation to adopt the resolution expressing the intent of the city of Muskegon to establish a recreational authority within the county of Muskegon and to appoint a representative of the city of Muskegon to join with the steering committee.
Mr. Johnson.
I move to adopt the resolution expressing the intent of the city of Muskegon to establish a recreational authority within the Muskegon County and to appoint a representative of the city of Muskegon to serve on that steering committee.
Second.
It's been moved by Commissioner Johnson, seconded by Commissioner Warren to adopt the resolution expressing the intent of the city of Muskegon to establish a recreational authority within the county of Muskegon and to appoint a representative of the city of Muskegon to join with the steering committee. This was before us at a work session earlier. Some questions and concerns were raised. I think in the interim we received a healthy amount of answers to a number of those questions and some clarifications. But Commissioner Johnson, and we do have members of the Rec Authority work group with us here this evening to flesh out anything additional. So did you want to lead out at this point? And
sure. I sent an email with updates of follow-up questions. Hope everyone got that and had a chance to review that. And also, as the commission asked, we extended an open invitation to members of the steering committee, the preliminary steering committee for this Parks and Rec Authority. And we have a few members here, as well as Connie Maxine Sparrow with Muskegon County. She's been providing project admin support for this, moving this endeavor forward to see if there is sufficient municipal support throughout the county to partner on a Parks and Rec Authority. So she's here to speak on it, as well as answer any questions. And we do also have Jan Duer with Fruitland Township, and Kim Arter with Laketon Township, and Greg Halbrand with City of Whitehall as well to maybe answer some questions that you have, as well as give their input and thoughts about why they may or may not be participating in the Parks and Rec Authority, and maybe add some of their own concerns or what they are excited or most enthused about in this collaborative endeavor. But thank you, Connie.
No, thank you. I appreciate you guys having me. It sounds like you guys have had some pretty diligent discussions, so I think maybe more than me spewing repetitive information, probably questions that you may have for me as project support for this, as well as other steering committee members would probably be great.
Very good. Commissioners, from our last discussion and materials recently received, do you have any questions for Ms. Maxim Sparrow at this point? Commissioner Warren.
I think I saw somewhere, oh, here it is, never mind. I was gonna ask about the frequently asked questions, but I guess my question would be, how would residents look at this document? Is it on the Muskegon County website?
The frequently asked questions can be, yes, we can post them. I sent them out initially as a draft to add more as commissions continue to gather them, but we can post them, certainly.
Okay, great.
Okay, anything else?
Oh, I was just going to ask how the process is going and what people have been supportive, you know, what other ones are there?
It's been fun. There's been lively conversation. I just actually, we had an amendment to the act that happened in August. The legislature amended it, and now we have lots of school districts that are very interested in being part of the steering committee as well. So I just left Muskegon Heights Public School Academy, and they passed their resolution. Muskegon Public Schools is passing their resolution. Muskegon Township has passed resolution. And I know that there are several others in the midst of the same stages that you are. We've had positive and constructive input, I would say. Some are concerned about, and I'll be honest, the non-contiguous maybe layover of spaces within Muskegon County that aren't connected, for example, Montague and the city of Muskegon. And that's understandable. I think that we would be one of only two counties in the state that would actually have a countywide recreation authority. I think that people are wondering how that looks to have a Roosevelt Park and a Dalton Township together. I think one of the things the school district is recognizing is that they have ample athletic facilities that they would like to see more programming come back to, which is what you see happening with the North Ottawa Recreation Authority. They're the ones that run the Spring Lake Aquatic Center, which works very, very well, and it's actually generating revenue to continue maintenance of the pool itself. So there are examples across the state. I think that this is a concept where we look at countywide and everybody's like, does that make sense because of some of our geography? And I graduated from Whitehall, I get it. But I think as we look at collective resources and having staff support, grant support, and planning support for something like this, I think we're going to be able to get more bang for our buck.
Just wondering if you'd gotten clarification perhaps from the county's legal counsel with regard to what programming or facilities are permissible within a parks rec if it were to be supported by you know, millage and operated. We're not looking at a millage, just to reiterate that. But trails aren't explicitly mentioned.
No, but
the thought was that it could be included within parks. Has your legal counsel, the counties, weighed in on that? And have we gotten any additional indications from Lansing whether or not that's their intent to have trails be inclusive within parks?
So trails are considered a greenway by definition, and you can talk to your Muskegon's council, but the definition for a park is very robust, including beaches and shorelines. So it's depending on how you're going to define it, and they left it open that way on purpose. I know that Doug Hughes, who is our council, did do some research, but it's not anything finite, though. Just like any other trail, as long as you have easements and permissions, it's certainly something that can be covered as a recreational activity.
Okay. Could you maybe speak to, because I didn't delve into too much of the details of the Tiger Grant application, but
sure.
Could you maybe speak to the commission about that and how the our participation in the Parks and Rec Authority could help bolster the prospect of getting that grant and what you and the county intend to use that grant money for?
So the county is going after a Tiger Grant. We have a variety of, and Tiger is a transportation improvement. There's an acronym to it. Know that it's federal dollars that are really for unique transportation projects that are innovative. I think they funded a $43 million bridge in Detroit that was like honors half of the community and covers the expressway so that people can walk between two different communities. So it's rather large and very broad in the type of applications you can submit. We have a variety of trails that connect in the city because the city has done very well as some of our townships like Laketon Township. However, we do still have some urban and some rural areas that have no trails, including the city of Muskegon Heights. So as we look at, though they have sidewalks, but as we look at the county and connecting these trails, one of the pieces that we see, especially for economic development and tourism, is connecting our trails to regional trails, the North Ottawa Trail System, Kent County's, Nuevo's, Oceana's. And so the goal is to be able to go after one of those Tiger Grants to create a comprehensive countywide trail system. Is the Recreation Authority necessary to go after that Tiger Grant? No. Does it make it much easier to negotiate all the easements, all the property negotiations for those bike trails? Absolutely, because the Rec Authority can work on behalf of everyone rather than trying to implement all of these trails on behalf of 25 different municipalities. That's a very large project management task. Not that it's not possible, it's just a full-time job to be able to implement. So the Recreation Authority would have the ability to actually implement those trails projects on behalf of the municipalities with which is in its territory, and it's going to make things a lot more streamlined.
Okay. And with that money, one of the possible projects would be an overpass on Seaway Shoreline Drive.
Yes.
To help connect the Lakeshore Trail with the Laketon Trail, and also kind of maybe help us meet, which has been part of the Downtown Development Authority's goal since its founding a few decades ago, improve access to our waterfront from our downtown, and something like that could very much help us improve access with that overpass, if that's still in the works.
It is.
As a possibility.
Yes, MDOT has actually engineered two trail bridges. There's a variety of different names for these things. MDOT has already engineered two trail bridges for us. One that would be wherever the city of Muskegon would prefer it. Obviously, I know that getting across Lakeshore is something that everybody talks about. But then the other one would be twin to it, that's at Hoyt and Mona Lake Park Seaway Drive, to connect the city over back to Mona Lake, so that the kids have a safe way to get to Mona Lake Park without crossing Seaway Drive. Same concept, much faster cars, same problem. Mm-hmm. There's not an efficient sidewalk in the world or crosswalk that's going to make people feel comfortable. So there are two MDOT estimates, both of them at $1.2 million apiece. I do have engineering design for those. I can certainly share them with you so that you could see, and obviously this would go through planning with the city, and that's part of the benefit of having the Rec Authority is working within the territory. The city is already part of that, so we have a lot less hoops to jump through to implement things like very large trail bridges that we can go. It has to be 30 feet tall to get past the railroad easement that's required for height. So those are just some of those finite details that come with that Tiger Grant that with a Rec Authority is going to make things much easier and much more seamless.
You're good. Are any of the other members, do you have any observations or input that you would like to impart to the City Commission as we consider?
I have one.
If you could, just for the sake of protocol, and you could just give your name and position so it can be read into the...
Greg Hillebrand, I'm representing the city of Whitehall, and thank you for letting me speak.
Absolutely.
This is a resolution of intent, so it doesn't make any commitment on the part of the city of Muskegon to actually join the Recreation Authority. It's a way for you to voice your intent to join the authority once the articles of incorporation have been drawn up and you have a chance to look at them and then decide if you want to join or not. So you can always opt out. I don't know if that was clear. City of Whitehall, yeah. is still, you know, the council will decide whether or not they are going to sign the resolution of intent. I am the representative that's bringing the information to the city of Whitehall. The concern that I have voiced to the city manager and the mayor is what Connie mentioned, which is the contiguous nature of nearly all other recreation authorities in the state of Michigan. They are smaller, primarily 2 to 4 municipalities that come together that are contiguous in nature, that have a common interest, that makes a lot of sense. So we're still kind of trying to figure out if this is the right thing to do or not.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Say hi to the mayor and Scott for me.
Oh.
All right. Any other?
Good evening. I'm Jan Dewar from the Township of Fruitland. Our township board faced essentially the same decision that you are facing last night. The Fruitland Township Board has discussed this at a couple of different meetings, And there were several questions that have been raised and have been discussed, not only by the steering committee right now, but also amongst our board members. Some of the questions that we think are still open are whether or not for a Tiger grant, the rec authority is indeed the best approach, or whether there is other ways of interurban cooperation, intergovernmental cooperation that could be used. There were also some questions about whether or not the project that we have, and I think we all can appreciate a good trail system through the county, but I think there are some questions about whether or not we have sufficient detail yet to know which jurisdictions it's going to benefit, et cetera. So those were some of the questions that were raised amongst a few others. The bottom line is, last night our township board did approve the resolution to go ahead and join the effort. We recognize that this is just an expression of intent, and whether or not we go forward in actually joining the formal rec authority, I think will be determined by, you know, how things progress and what we see at the rec authority doing and what the projects might be in the future.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Any other final comments?
Yeah, I just want to thank the three of you and Connie for coming out. By the way, Kim was the one I was telling you at our work session about some of the best practices we've learned from other municipalities, and one of the things that stuck out for me that I mentioned before was that they had worked with Baker and had a class at Baker do their Parks and Recreation master plan. So I just thought that was a nice partnership that they had pursued, and with good results for them. But thank you, Jan. Thank you, Kim. Thank you, Greg, for coming on and speaking. I think they made a really good point emphasizing that this is just a letter of intent. This is just having us, if we do approve this, saying that we want to participate in some kind of Parks and Rec authority. Maybe it's not a countywide one, but that we want to have a seat at the table in terms of looking at crafting the articles of incorporation, what the exact parameters are going to be. And maybe it ends up being, through this process, three different Parks and Rec authorities that are more localized, contiguous. But this resolution is basically just conveying that we want to be collaborative with our neighboring and nearby municipalities, and we want to work together to improve Muskegon County, especially recreationally. So I would hope that we approve this letter of intent so we can continue this process and move forward hand in hand with our neighbors. So, thank you.
Seats at tables and collaboration is often a good thing. So, there's nothing else. Roll call, please.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Sibiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Garwin?
Well, as long as everybody else. Yeah. Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. I know it's a busy week, and you got to go home and put the turkey in cold water and get that thawed.
Yeah.
So, best to you all, and bless you and yours. Any other business, commissioners? Commissioner Johnson?
I just want to congratulate our Vice Mayor Hood on his election as president of the NAACP local chapter here in Muskegon, a chapter that's been around for over a century now. And our vice mayor is the incoming president, so I just want to congratulate him on that. And as both a lifetime subscribing member to the NAACP and as your fellow commissioner, I look forward to working with you and the NAACP on cultivating more equitable community for all residents.
Congratulations, Vice Mayor.
Thank you.
Anything else? Commissioner Warren?
I just, on a personal note, want to announce I have a 4-week-old son now, as of today.
I thought you were going to say you're pregnant again.
My heart just dropped. No, so 4 weeks old today, little Levon. And so I just want to, besides announce how excited Mitch and I are, say thank you to citizens and city staff and my fellow commissioners and the mayor for all the well wishes and support during this process. So thank
you. And you know I love that name.
Levon?
Yeah, and you know why?
Elton John?
No.
Why?
Levon Helms.
Did you know that song is about Levon Helm? Did you know that's why he wrote it, Elton John?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I just think my text said I knew another Levon involved with Big Pink.
That's true.
Okay. No, I love it. Don't forget Christmas in the city this weekend. Dave, want to come up and tell the public about all the great stuff we have looking here?
Dave Alexander, downtown Muskegon now, and we just want to welcome all of you out Saturday. First off, it is Small Business Saturday, and that will be from 11 to 4. Downtown retailers and institutions will be open and welcoming. And then in the evening, 5:30 to 6:30 at Hackley Park, we'll have the lighting of the community Christmas tree, and the mayor will say some proclamation words for welcoming Santa Claus. Santa will be coming down from Hackley Hume House on wagon. And the downtown will be pretty electric, I hope, with some good weather predicted. One other thing I'd like to mention from a downtown standpoint is that Hamburger Mikey opened to great success today. If you were trying to get in, you probably didn't because it was jammed. The Chad across the street, who has bought the old Matson Oles property, wondered what happened to his parking lot because it was filled with cars for the first time since he's had it back in August. So come down and experience that along with the West Coast Vinyl, the record store that's in there. There's going to be some more restaurant moves that we'll see here in the coming weeks and months. And I would like to bring these businesses to you at a work session very briefly, just to introduce themselves, let them tell you what they're doing. They're going to ask you to change the name of Third Street. They will want to market themselves, and we would just like a resolution of support that you would recognize that you would go with their marketing name. And this is something coming up from the grassroots, something that we're not imposing upon them, but they're going to be asking of their city to recognize. So sometime maybe in the January, February time frame, we'll work with Kathy and Frank to bring them in if we could for a brief presentation and let them get to know you and you them.
Very good.
Have a great Thanksgiving. Thanks.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
And this coming Small Business Saturday, which we did issue a resolution that went out nationally, don't forget to support your local businesses all along the Lakeshore. We can have a lot of fun with that here in Muskegon, our businesses downtown, follow the Lakeshore into Lakeside, all kinds of fun and interesting spots down there as well, but I have a bad tooth, so I won't be getting any sweets. Get out there, support those businesses that we've come to call mom and pops. There's a reason we do that, because they're our next door neighbors, and they're the lifeblood and the energy of this community. So, anything else, commissioners? If not, are there any members of the public that would like to address the commission? If not, Vice Mayor, take us home.
If there's nothing else, I move to adjourn.
Support. All in favor?
Aye.
Groovy.